where we left off last time, I always feel like this is like a mystery show or a crime show where I gotta give a little recap at the beginning and then I have to like set up a cliffhanger at the end. So maybe I watched Alias too much when it was on so many years ago. Here's where we left off. We left off looking at what the server was creating in our dictionary example. And what the server was creating was a delimited, I'm going to use the word file, but it's not really like a file in the sense that it's not stored on disk. It's just data that's passed. But it sends back delimited data, probably would be a better way to put it. And what does delimited data mean? Delimited data means there are special characters which separate pieces of data from each other. Now, we actually have two delimiters in this file. Because if you remember, as you type in an English word, you get back something that looks like this. And then so on. You get back pairs of values. And the pairs are separated by colons, if I remember right. And the data within the pair are separated by semicolons. Now, I might have that backwards, but I don't think so. I think it's semicolons between the fields and then colons between the records. In the old days, we would have called these records and fields. In other words, if we were going to look at this, if we were making a spreadsheet for it, it would look like this. Absolute value, and then an index of 0. Addition, and then an index of 1 down the line. And each group of pieces of data about one thing is called a record, at least in the old days when we did file processing. So, there could be more things in here, right? More than two. If we're returning data about a person, for example, it might contain their name, their email address, their phone number, their address, and so on down the line. So there could be a bunch of fields, but everything about one member of this chunk of data is called a record. And then each individual piece of data would be called a field. So just to use those terms. So there are two fields and I've shown two records, but however many records there would be, there'd be one record per word and two fields per each record. Now, with delimited data, our job is to parse. And parse is a word that is funny. I remember like a few years ago, I would talk about parsing and parsing and parsing. And one of my students finally said, what does parsing mean? All right? Because it's true. It's not a word that really shows up in ordinary conversation too often, you know. What are you doing tonight? I think I'm gonna be parsing some data. You know, it doesn't really come up in conversation. So what do I mean by parsing? By parsing, I mean taking a big chunk of data and breaking it down into its pieces. This comes back, remember, as just one giant string. This comes back in the variable HTTP response text. So all the data that comes back from an AJAX request, if we're using delimited data, comes back as one giant string of data. But obviously, there's more to it than that, right? Because it isn't one giant string of data. It's actually records of data and fields of data. So we need to break down this string, all right, which is however long it is. We need to break it down first into records. So we need to break it down first into the individual words, And then we need to break the records down into the individual fields. And then we can do something about it. Because ultimately, what we want to produce is we want to produce a drop-down that looks like this. And this is something I always encourage you to do if you're doing any sort of web development, is have in your mind the HTML that you want to produce. All right? You want to produce a drop-down, all right, that will show the list of words. What is that drop-down going to look like? It's going to look like this. Select. And then there's going to be a series of options. And in our case, just to do the first two options, this is what we want. And so on, for however many words we have a match of. In order to do that, we have to take this giant string, break it into its individual fields. Each one of these records is going to become an option. And then each option is going to have the value, which is going to be the number, the index, and the word, which is going to be the text of the option. So we can't just create our drop down directly from this data. We have to break it down into its pieces first. And that process of taking a big string of data and breaking it down into its pieces is known as parsing. Alright? So we're going to break it down into its individual records, and each record we're going to break down into its individual fields. And then for each record we're going to create an option in our drop down that looks like this, whose value is the index, and whose text is the name of the word. So that's our job, and that's what we're going to look at today. All right? And we'll see, we should be able to get through this, and we might be able to go through the next part of this. So, server side that creates that big blob of data, that creates that big string of data. And essentially what it does is it loops through our array of words and it looks for a match. And it uses the strpos function to look for what the user has keyed in to see if that matches the beginning of the word in the array. Remember, if we type in an A, in this particular case, we only want words that start with A. All right? Now, if we had a different problem, we might match things up in a different way. For example, if we were looking for titles, if we were searching through a library for titles, you know, the famous book by Charles Dickens. Is that called Tale of Two Cities? Is it called A Tale of Two Cities? Or is it called The Tale of Two Cities? Well, I know it's not the last one, but we'll pretend that I don't know. But I'm really not sure if it's the first one or the second one. Is it Tale of Two Cities or A Tale of Two Cities? I don't know. So if I was searching for that, I might want to just type in Tale, T-A-L-E. All right? In that case, if I was looking through a list of books, I might not care where that string appears. If it appears right off at the beginning or if it appears somewhere in the middle, that's fine. Or if I was looking for a book about jazz music, I might just want to type in jazz, and I wouldn't care if it matched the beginning, the middle, or the end of the book title. All right? But in this particular case, I'm interested in finding the string at the start of the word. So if I type in an A, I don't want every word that contains an A. I want the words that start with A. And if I type in AB, I want the words that start with AB and not the words that just contain an AB somewhere in them. So therefore, I'm looking for that string position. I'm looking for my word to be in position 0 of the array list. So that's what that means. String position, I'm looking for in the array list, each item individually, I'm looking for the substring that the user typed in that comes across on the query string. I'm looking to see if that value equals 0. That value equals 0 indicates that it's the beginning of the word, is in position 0. So if I type in A, the 0th letter, which humans would call the first letter, all right, but would be an A. And again, I'm passing data via the query string. The query string is one of the only ways to pass data from the client to the server. So we're doing everything with the query string in this case. You could also pass it as part of the form collection, which you would not see on the query string, but I think for the most part, you know, the query string allows us to see what's going on a little clearer, and therefore we use that. Again, to reiterate, if I go here and type in localhost / dictionary1.php ?word equals A, that's what I get. Just as I described, the records are separated by colons, the fields within a record are separated by semicolons. And again, I could have more than two fields, right? If the situation required it. So, this is one giant string. This comes back to the client as response text. Actually, our object response text. And when the AJAX request is finished, a special status gets sent back to the client. And that status is a ready state of 4. Remember, when the ready state changes, our callback function kicks in. So let's look at the client and let's see how the client takes this giant string of data and breaks it down into its pieces in order to make the dropdown. So, let me go in here and let's look at dictionary.html. Okay, remember, this is a first request. This request gets kicked off when the user actually lifts up their key after typing. Because at that point, the text is actually, the character that the user typed is actually in the text box. And so, we do a little bit of validation to make sure that there's something in there. Because if there's nothing in there, there's nothing in the text box, we don't need to check the database. Not our database, but our array. So, if there's nothing in the field, the text box, we simply blank out the dropdown. How do we blank out the dropdown? We set the options length to 0. What that does is, really, a dropdown, from a DOM perspective, is simply an array of options. So we simply set the length of that array to 0. That means there's no options in this dropdown. So if there's nothing in the text box, remember, on key down, we call this get words, and we pass it this dot value meaning the value that's in the text box. If there's nothing in that argument, then we just go ahead and clear out the drop down. Otherwise, we make our AJAX request. Here we have something to work with. All right? And what we do is we call dictionary1.php ?word equals, and we pass it the value that was typed in the text box. We then set our callback function, or onReadyStateChange function, to be createDB. What does that mean again? That means that as the request gets processed by the server, the client receives a notification that the request is progressing. And there's really only one status that we're interested in. We're interested in a status of 4. A status of 4 means that the server has done its job and has returned the data. So the data is available to be used. Statuses 0, 1, 2, and 3 simply mean, well, the request hasn't been made yet, the request has been made, the server's thinking about it, the response is on its way. We're not really interested in these. We might be interested in them if our AJAX request took a long time for the server to process. Because we might want to update the user saying, hey, the server got your request, or in some user-friendly terms. The user got your request, the server's thinking, or the server got your request, the server's thinking about it. Oh, here comes your answer, then bam, there's your answer. But in a case like this, our response is pretty quick from the server. So therefore, we're not really interested in giving, we don't really need to give a progress report. We simply, when we're done, we simply are interested in that. Now again, notice that that matches what I typed in on the query string. That's one of the troubleshooting techniques. Make sure your server-side code works first. How do you make sure the server-side code works? You make sure it works by actually typing in the URL manually and getting back the results that you expected that you get. If that doesn't work, there's no hope for this to work. All right? Your client-side code isn't going to fix a problem with your server-side code, right? So, that's why I encourage you to test the server-side code first. Now, the other thing that you can do for troubleshooting is make sure that the client-side is making the request the way that you would expect it. And that's where you'd put an alert in to simply display, I won't actually do it, but put in an alert that will display what actually the client is calling on the server side. Because if I did that right, that should match what I have been typing in to test my server side. And in that way, I can notice if the communication between the client and the server is happening the way that it needs to, the way that I'm expecting it to. A lot of times, little tiny issues, like for example, maybe you forgot an ampersand between fields, if you're passing two fields. Or maybe you called, the server's expecting word, and you're sending value on the query string, or something like that. Okay. So I've defined my callback function as createDB. So what I mean by a callback function is when the ready state changes, when the status changes, createDB gets called. And that happens automatically. That's not code that you have to write. That's just a function of that HTTP, or rather XML HTTP request object. When the status changed, whatever function I have listed here gets called. All right. So, I make the request. It runs through the update statuses. I am only interested in a status of 4. So I have my code is in a big if statement that checks to see if the status is equal to 4. Again, because I'm not really interested in any of those intermediary states. I'm only interested when this is done. Alright? So, when this is done, that means we have a winner. We have an answer from the server. So now, let the parsing begin. Alright? So, what am I going to do? The first thing I'm going to do is I am going to get the response from the server, and I'm storing it in a variable called response. Alright? I create a variable called aOption. We're going to need that in a minute here. I grab a pointer, I grab a reference to the dropdown, and I set the dropdown length equal to 0. Why do I need to do that? Why do I set the options, length of the options to 0? We've seen that code before. What does that do? DD options length equals 0. In other words, it gets rid of all the options that are there before. What if I didn't have this piece of code in here? What would happen?
There'd still be stuff in the dropdown.
Right. And well, then what would we do? Well, then we'd add new stuff to it.
Yeah.
So every time we typed in something, we would get like duplicate entries. In fact, let's go and do that. And I'll even put my alert in. I said I wasn't going to do it, but I'll put my alert in because I do think in this and in all my classes, I stress the need to have a systematic approach to debugging and not simply staring at your code, but have some process that you go through of things that you check. Again, how do I want to say this? There's no recipe that I can say, do this, 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 and this, and you'll have your answer. But I can give you things to do and communicate an approach that will help you find your answer a lot quicker than just staring at the code or trying things. So I'm going to go and I put my alert in, and I'm going to comment out that line. And we'll see what happens. So I type in A. Dictionary1.php word equals A. So that matches what the server's expecting from what we had done previously, if you remember. All right. So now, notice it contains all the A's, which is good, which is what we want. But now notice what happens if I type in AD. All right. It's still making the request correctly. But notice that it didn't clear out the other stuff. So I have absolute value, accuracy, addition, blah, blah, blah. And then, guess what? I have those again at the bottom of the drop-down list. All right? So that's why we need to clear it out. I'm going to get rid of the alert. Again, you can comment it out. Sometimes it's good when you have debug code to just comment it out because, you know, you can always use it again unless you're an optimist and you think this is the absolute last problem that I'm ever going to have with this code, and therefore I can eliminate my debug code forever. At the very least, while you're still developing it, you might want to leave it in. When you get ready to release it, maybe then you can go and clear the comments out. But all right, so I'm going to put that back in, and now notice the difference. Now as I type in,
I type in, shows me a list of terms. I type in a second thing, and it clears out what's there before. So that's the effect of this line. And again, where did we see this before? We saw this before if there's nothing in the text box to just get rid of everything. All right. So now we can parse it. And we're going to use the split function two times. What does the split function do? The split function takes a string and makes an array out of it. All right? That's what the split function does. All right? So, again, parsing is taking a big piece of data and breaking it down into its original, or breaking it down into meaningful pieces. The split helps us do that. So, we're going to split. We're going to do two splits. The first split that we're going to do is we're going to split that giant string using the colon. And we're going to create an array called A English. So I'm going to say A English equals split response, which is a variable that I put that data in, colon. So what is that going to do? That's going to take this big string, response, and create an array so that A English 0 equals absolute value semicolon 0. A sub 1 equals addition 1. A sub 2 equals. So to use the terminology I used before, we broke that big string of data into the individual records. So each row, each element in the A English array represents one record. It represents every piece of data that we have about one word. All right? So we do that. So we've started our parsing of it. All right? Because we've taken that big string of data and broken it down. What are we going to do next? We are going to loop through this array. We're going to do this for as many elements as we have here. And each trip through the loop, we are going to create a new option in our dropdown. Okay? We're going to create a new option in our dropdown. So we start our index at 0. We go as long as the A English array is. And each trip through the loop, we are going to create a second array called A option that's going to take each row in turn. So A option is going to be different each time through the loop. And we're going to split it using the semicolon. So A option sub 0, the first trip through the loop, is going to be equal to absolute value. A option sub 1 is going to be equal to 0. So we have successfully parsed that. We now have the values that we need to create our option. We simply then need to create an option to insert into our dropdown that has a value of this guy, and who has a text of this guy.
After we create the first option, we loop through and create an option for the second element in the A English array, then the third, then the fourth, then the fifth. And we do that until we've done every field in our data. So then we're done, and we've created our dropdown. So that's it in concept. Now let's see it in code. I actually wrote the split function wrong. You'll see what it should look like in a second. The split function actually should look like this. A English equals, I said split, HTTP response text colon. It should be HTTP response text dot split colon. And I really don't need this variable. I created that variable and I never use it. So you can ignore that. So this is the first split. So I've split that big string into its individual records. So now I have as many rows in A English as there are that got returned. I then loop through, and for each element in this array, I split the record. Remember, A English sub I contains each record that we're looking at in turn. The first time through it will contain the zeroth one, the second time one. And I split A option using the semicolon. So A option sub 0 is going to be the word, A option sub 1 is going to be the value. Now, this statement's a little tricky. In the past, when we have created HTML, we've used inner HTML. And we could do that here as well. All right? We could absolutely do that here and create a big giant string that contains all our option tags and then set the inner HTML. But there's actually a better way to do it. We can actually create those objects through our code and add them to the dropdown. So DD is our dropdown. We've gotten a pointer to it. We haven't used getElementById. We use the name of the dropdown. And we refer to it this way. Remember, that's simply an alternative way to point to an element on our page. And remember I said that a dropdown is really just an array of options. The DOM for a dropdown is really just an array of options. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to add to my dropdown an options array element. So I'm adding to the options of the dropdown. At what position I'm doing it? Well, whatever the current length is. Now this is a tricky part, right? Because what did we set the length of it up here to? We set it to 0. So right now, DD options length, the first time through the loop, has a value of 0. All right, because there's no options in there. So we're setting that array element to 0, to a new option that we're creating. So the first time through, we are creating a new option, and we're putting it in position 0 in the dropdown's option array. Now the second time we go through the loop, what will the value of DD options length be? It was 0 initially. So when we add this option, we add the option to the 0th position in the array. So now how many elements are in the array? How many?
0.
Now there was 0 to start with. That's what this does.
Yeah.
And after the first time we've added one, all right, how many will there be? This isn't a trick question. We had 0, and we added 1. The fact that this seems to be a puzzling question indicates that we're not understanding something here. All right? So if we started with 0, if I have 0 cookies on the table, and I add 1 cookie to the table, how many cookies do we have on the table? We have 1. All right. Substitute options for cookies and substitute drop down for table, and it's the exact same question. We started out with 0 cookies on the table, 0 options in the drop down. After the first iteration of the loop, we have added a cookie to the table / option to the drop down. So now we have 1 option in the dropdown. So the second time we execute this loop, we're going to create a new option. And in what position are we adding it? Well, how many are in there now? There's 1. So we're adding it in position 1. Third time through the loop, how many are in there? There's 2. We're adding our new option in position 2. So after the third time through the loop, there are 3 elements. So each trip through the loop, we're adding a new option to the dropdown. So that increases the value of this. All right? That increases the value. So the next time through the loop, we're going to add the option 1 position further. So DD options has a value of 0 initially. We go through our first loop. We parse the record to get the 2 fields. We create a new option using this as the text and this as the value. That's the syntax to create a new option object. And again, the first argument is the text. The second argument is the value. And we add that new option object to our dropdown. How do we add it? Well, we point to the array of options, and we put that new option in whatever the length currently is. So before we've added any, that length is 0. So the first one that we add goes in position 0, which is the top one on the list. All right? And then, after we've done it, then the length of the dropdown is no longer 0, it's 1. So the second dropdown then comes in, or the second value set of values comes in, and we add it in position 1, add it in position 2, and so on. Each trip through the loop, we're adding it 1 step further with what indicates the new length. What could be useful in some cases is I actually put alerts in. You could put an alert to show DD options length, and you'd see how it goes from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. We could put an alert to show the value of A option 0 and A option 1 to see how we're looping through the result text. But the effect of all this is when we are done, we have a dropdown that contains a set of options, the text of which is the word, and the value of which is the index in the array. Now, I've been typing in A all the time, so our numbers start with 0. But if I were to type in S, for example, notice that we get those higher numbers, right? Because
S is further along in the alphabet, so this isn't at the start of the array, this is somewhere in the middle of the array. So, if we were to do this within our Ajax, our dropdown contains, for the text, scientific notation of that option, the value it contains, whatever that array element was. Unfortunately, if we do a view source, we don't get to see that. Because the view source shows us what was sent back originally when we first requested this page, not what we've manipulated Ajax-wise. Any questions about this? The thing to keep in mind is that each time through the loop, we are adding an option to that dropdown. How do we add it? Well, we split the record into its two fields. We do this to create a options object. All right, that's a DOM expression. It's nothing I made up. That's how you create a new option for a dropdown. And then we add it to the list of options that are contained in that dropdown. And the thing to keep in mind is that each trip through, since we've added a new option, each iteration through the loop, the value of DD options length goes up by one each time through. So each new option we're adding after the previous option. So if there's 10 options, we added one in position 0, one in position 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Questions on this? We can revisit this more in detail next week if we need to, if you have questions with it. Because we're going to see this. This is actually, there's two things that change in the different versions of this. Remember, we have actually three versions of this application. One that does XML data, one that does JSON data, and this one which does delimited data. The thing that's different between these two, between the three versions, number one, the server-side code is different because we're pumping out the data in a different format. And this create DD, which parses the output of the server, is different. Now, to go full circle and to finish this up, we're going to do the very last step. And the very last step is really, really, really simple. All right? Because we have a button that says get translation. So I pick second degree, and I click go, and I get the translation into Spanish. All right? This is really straightforward. We have an onClick, get translation. Now, that also is going to make an Ajax request, but it's going to make a different kind of Ajax request. It's not going to get a list of things. It's going to get one value. That is, it's going to get the Spanish translation for that. Now, I'm grabbing the value of the, this could be replaced by I document, this could be replaced by dot value. This is sort of an older way of doing it. But I grab the value of the selected index. If that value equals negative 1, then that represents select a valid word. Because if you remember our server-side code, if there are no valid words, it sends back a message that there are no valid words, and it supplies a value of negative 1. So if the value of the drop-down option is negative 1, that means they haven't selected a valid word. At any rate, so if they selected something as a value of negative 1, that represents it's not a valid word. So we display that message. We don't even have to ask the server for that because we know negative 1 means it's invalid. However, if they have selected a valid word, we call dictionary2.php and give it an index of whatever the value of that dropdown was. We We then say on ready state change, display translation. And let's see what Dictionary 2 does. Dictionary 2 is probably the simplest program you're going to see in this class. It simply takes that index and returns the element in the Spanish array that corresponds to that index. So if I've picked element 37 from the array that corresponds to the English word 37, the value in the Spanish array of 37 is the corresponding translation. Remember that we have this array. Which I turned a parallel array because the values match up. So number 3 is addition in English. If I look at the Spanish translation, element 1, 2, 3 is a Spanish translation for addition. So that's all the server does. So if I pick Dictionary2.php ?index equals 2 simply returns a Spanish translation for it. This is simple data. This isn't even delimited data. It's simply one value. So there's no need to parse this, right? My response text is my answer. I don't need to break that answer down into its pieces so that I can create something with it. Whatever I get back from the server is my answer. So therefore, my HTML, when I've gotten an answer, I can simply take that answer, the response text, and pop it into the inner HTML of my results field, my results div. So I simply pop the answer right there. The second part of this stays the same for all of them because there's really no need to send the data back in any other format. All right? And that brings back an interesting consideration that we'll talk about more next time is don't consider one of these options as being superior to the other option. They're tools. What I mean by that is delimited data, XML, and JSON. We'll see how they have their own distinct advantages and drawbacks. So it's not like one is a better version of the other. It just depends on the problem that you're trying to solve. You know? Screwdriver is a perfectly good tool, right? But not if you need to nail a nail into a board. You need a hammer for that. So you're not going to look at a situation where you need to nail something and say, well, a hammer is the best tool because I used it to do this. Well, yeah, it was the best tool in that situation. It's not universally the better tool. Same idea with delimited XML and JSON. For any given problem, one of them might be a better way of doing it than the other. But that's not a universal thing. That's for that specific problem. All right, we'll continue this. If some of these concepts are fuzzy, remember, we get to see the same code again next week, just with slightly different versions. So study it. If you have any questions, you can ask them now. We'll also go over this more next week. Are there any questions now? All right. We'll see you in lab.
Okay, where we left off last time, I always feel like this is like a mystery show or a crime show where I give a little recap at the beginning and then I have to like set up a cliffhanger at the end. So maybe I watched Alias too much when it was on so many years ago. Here's where we left off. We left off looking at what the server was creating in our dictionary example. And what the server was creating was a delimited, I'm going to use the word file, but it's not really like a file in the sense that it's not stored on disk. It's just data that's passed. But it sends back delimited data, probably would be a better way to put it. And what does delimited data mean? Delimited data means there are special characters which separate pieces of data from each other. Now, we actually have two delimiters in this file. Because if you remember, as you type in an English word, you get back something that looks like this. And then so on. You get back pairs of values. And the pairs are separated by colons, if I remember right. And the data within the pair are separated by semicolons. Now, I might have that backwards, but I don't think so. I think it's semicolons between the fields and then colons between the records. In the old days, we would have called these records and fields. In other words, if we were going to look at this, if we were making a spreadsheet for it, it would look like this. Absolute value, and then an index of 0. Addition, and then an index of 1 down the line. And each group of pieces of data about one thing is called a record, at least in the old days when we did file processing. So there could be more things in here, right? More than two. If we're returning data about a person, for example, it might contain their name, their email address, their phone number, their address, and so on down the line. So there could be a bunch of fields, but everything about one member of this chunk of data is called a record, and then each individual piece of data would be called a field. So just to use those terms. So there are two fields, and I've shown two records, but however many records there would be, there'd be one record per word and two fields per each record. Now, with delimited data, our job is to parse. And parse is a word that is funny. I remember like a few years ago, I would talk about parsing and parsing and parsing. And one of my students finally said, what does parsing mean? All right? Because it's true. It's not a word that really shows up in ordinary conversation too often, you know. What are you doing tonight? I think I'm gonna be parsing some data. You know, it doesn't really come up in conversation. So what do I mean by parsing? By parsing, I mean taking a big chunk of data and breaking it down into its pieces. This comes back, remember, as just one giant string. This comes back in the variable HTTP response text. So all the data that comes back from a AJAX request, if we're using delimited data, comes back as one giant string of data. But obviously, there's more to it than that, right? Because it isn't one giant string of data. It's actually records of data and fields of data. So we need to break down this string, all right, which is however long it is. We need to break it down first into records. So we need to break it down first into the individual words. And then we need to break the records down into the individual fields. And then we can do something about it. Because ultimately, what we want to produce is we want to produce a drop-down that looks like this. And this is something I always encourage you to do if you're doing any sort of web development, is have in your mind the HTML that you want to produce. All right? You want to produce a drop-down, all right, that will show the list of words. What is that drop-down going to look like? It's going to look like this. Select And then there's going to be a series of options. And in our case, just to do the first two options, this is what we want. And so on, for however many words we have a match of. In order to do that, we have to take this giant string, break it into its individual fields. Each one of these records is going to become an option. And then each option is going to have the value, which is going to be the number, the index, and the word, which is going to be the text of the option. So we can't just create our dropdown directly from this data. We have to break it down into its pieces first. And that process of taking a big string of data and breaking it down into its pieces is known as parsing. All right? So we're going to break it down into its individual records. And each record we're going to break down into its individual fields. And then for each record, we're going to create an option in our dropdown that looks like this, whose value is the index and whose text is the name of the word. So that's our job, and that's what we're going to look at today. All right? And we'll see. We should be able to get through this, and we might be able to go through the next part. Of this. So, let's look at the code. Last time, if you recall, we discussed the code that runs on the server side that creates that big blob of data, that creates that big string of data. And essentially what it does is it loops through our array of words and it looks for a match. And it uses the strpos function to look for what the user is keyed in to see if that matches the beginning of the word in the array. Remember, if we type in an A, in this particular case, we only want words that start with A. All right? Now, if we had a different problem, we might match things up in a different way. For example, if we were looking for titles, if we were searching through a library for titles, the famous book by Charles Dickens, is that called Tale of Two Cities? Is it called A Tale of Two Cities? Or is it called The Tale of Two Cities? Well, I know it's not the last one, but we'll pretend that I don't know. But I'm really not sure if it's the first one or the second one. Is it Tale of Two Cities or A Tale of Two Cities? I don't know. So if I was searching for that, I might want to just type in Tale, T-A-L-E. All right? In that case, if I was looking through a list of books, I might not care where that string appears. If it appears right off at the beginning or if it appears somewhere in the middle, that's fine. Or if I was looking for a book about jazz music, I might just want to type in jazz, and I wouldn't care if it matched the beginning, the middle, or the end of the book title. All right? But in this particular case, I'm interested in finding the string at the start of the word. So if I type in an A, I don't want every word that contains an A. I want the words that start with A. And if I type in AB, I want the words that start with AB and not the words that just contain an AB somewhere in them. So therefore, I'm looking for that string position I'm looking for my word to be in position 0 of the array list. So that's what that means. String position, I'm looking for in the array list, each item individually, I'm looking for the substring that the user typed in that comes across on the query string. I'm looking to see if that value equals 0. That value equals 0 indicates that it's the beginning of the word, is in position 0. So if I type in A, the 0th letter, which humans would call the first letter, all right, but would be an A. And again, I'm passing data via the query string. The query string is one of the only ways to pass data from the client to the server. So we're doing everything with the query string in this case. You could also pass it as part of the form collection, which you would not see on the query string, but I think for the most part, you know, the query string allows us to see what's going on a little clearer, and therefore we use that. Again, to reiterate, if I go here and type in localhost / dictionary1.php ?word equals A, that's what I get. Just as I described, the records are separated by colons, the fields within a record are separated by semicolons. And again, I could have more than two fields, right? If the situation required it. So this is one giant string. This comes back to the client as response text. Actually, our object response text. And when the AJAX request is finished, a special status gets sent back to the client. And that status is a ready state of 4. Remember, when the ready state changes, our callback function kicks in. So let's look at the client and let's see how the client takes this giant string of data and breaks it down into its pieces in order to make the dropdown. So, let me go in here and let's look at dictionary.html. Okay, remember, this is a first request. This request gets kicked off when the user actually lifts up their key after typing. Because at that point, the text is actually, the character that the user typed is actually in the text box. And so, we do a little bit of validation to make sure that there's something in there. Because if there's nothing in there, there's nothing in the text box, we don't need to check the database. Not our database, but our array. So, if there's nothing in the field, the text box, we simply blank out the dropdown. How do we blank out the dropdown? We set the options length to 0. What that does is, really, a dropdown, from a DOM perspective, is simply an array of options. So we simply set the length of that array to 0. That means there's no options in this dropdown. So if there's nothing in the text box, remember, on key down, we call this getWords, and we pass it this.value, this.value meaning the value that's in the text box. If there's nothing in that argument, then we just go ahead and clear out the dropdown. Otherwise, we make our AJAX request. Here we have something to work with. Alright? And what we do is we call dictionary1.php ?word equals, and we pass it the value that was typed in the text box. We then set our callback function, or onReadyStateChange function, to be createDD. What does that mean again? That means that as the request gets processed by the server, the client receives a notification that the request is progressing. And there's really only one status that we're interested in. We're interested in a status of 4. A status of 4 means that the server has done its job and has returned the data. So the data is available to be used. Statuses 0, 1, 2, and 3 simply mean, well, the request hasn't been made yet, the request has been made, the server's thinking about it, the response is on its way. We're not really interested in these. We might be interested in them if our AJAX request took a long time for the server to process. Because we might want to update the user saying, hey, the server got your request, or in some user-friendly terms. The user got your request, the server got your request, the server's thinking about it. Oh, here comes your answer. Then bam, there's your answer. But in a case like this, our response is pretty quick from the server. So therefore, we're not really interested in giving, we don't really need to give a progress report. We simply, when we're done, we simply are interested in that. Now again, notice that that matches what I typed in on the query string. That's one of the troubleshooting techniques. Make sure your server-side code works first. How do you make sure the server-side code works? You make sure it works by actually typing in the URL manually and getting back the results that you expected that you get. If that doesn't work, there's no hope for this to work. All right? Your client-side code isn't going to fix a problem with your server-side code, right? So, that's why I encourage you to test the server-side code first. Now, the other thing that you can do for troubleshooting is make sure that the client side is making the request the way that you would expect it. And that's where you'd put an alert in to simply display, I won't actually do it, but put in an alert that will display what actually the client is calling on the server side. Because if I did that right, that should match what I have been typing in to test my server side. And in that way, I can notice if the communication between the client and the server is happening the way that it needs to, the way that I'm expecting it to. All right. A lot of times, little tiny issues, like for example, maybe you forgot an ampersand between fields if you're passing two fields. Or maybe you called, the server's expecting word and you're sending value on the query string or something like that. Okay. So I've defined my callback function as createDD. So what I mean by a callback function is when the ready state changes, when the status changes, createDD gets called. And that happens automatically. That's not code that you have to write. That's just a function of that HTTP, or rather XML HTTP request object. When the status changed, whatever function I have listed here gets called. All right. So, I make the request. It runs through the update statuses. I am only interested in a status of 4. So I have my code is in a big if statement that checks to see if the status is equal to 4. Again, because I'm not really interested in any of those intermediary states. I'm only interested when this is done. All right. So, when this is done, that means we have a winner. We have an answer from the server. So now, let the parsing begin. All right? So, what am I going to do? The first thing I'm going to do is I am going to get the response from the server, and I'm storing it in a variable called response. All right? I create a variable called aOption. We're going to need that in a minute here. I grab a pointer, I grab a reference to the dropdown, and I set the dropdown length equal to 0. Why do I need to do that? Why do I set the options, length of the options to 0? We've seen that code before. What does that do? DD options length equals 0.
Well, it has a length of 0. Does that kind of translate as to kind of 0 content? Or
yeah. In other words, it gets rid of all the options that are there before. What if I didn't have this piece of code in here? What would happen?
There'd still be stuff in the dropdown.
Right. And well, then what would we do? Well, then we'd add new stuff to it.
Yeah.
So every time we typed in something, we would get like duplicate entries. In fact, let's go and do that. And I'll even put my alert in. I said I wasn't going to do it, but I'll put my alert in because I do think in this and in all my classes, I stress the need to have a systematic approach to debugging and not simply staring at your code, but have some process that you go through of things that you check. Again, how do I want to say this? There's no recipe that I can say, do this, 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 and this, and you'll have your answer. But I can give you things to do and communicate an approach that will help you find your answer a lot quicker than just staring at the code or trying things. So I'm going to go and I put my alert in and I'm going to comment out that line. And we'll see what happens. So I type in A. Dictionary1.php word equals A. So that matches what the server's expecting from what we had done previously, if you remember. All right. So now, notice it contains all the A's, which is good, which is what we want. But now notice what happens if I type in AD. All right. It's still making the request correctly. But notice that it didn't clear out the other stuff. So I have absolute value, accuracy, addition, blah, blah, blah. And then, guess what? I have those again at the bottom of the drop-down list. All right? So that's why we need to clear it out. I'm going to get rid of the alert. Again, you can comment it out. Sometimes it's good when you have debug code to just comment it out because, you know, you can always use it again unless you're an optimist and you think this is the absolute last problem that I'm ever going to have with this code and therefore I can eliminate my debug code forever. At the very least, while you're still developing it, you might want to leave it in. When you get ready to release it, maybe then you can go and clear the comments out. But all right, so I'm going to put that back in and now notice the difference. Now as I type in, shows me a list of terms. I type in a second thing and it clears out what's there before. So that's the effect of this line. And again, where did we see this before? We saw this before if there's nothing in the text box to just get rid of everything. All right. So now we can parse it. And we're going to use the split function two times. What does the split function do? The split function takes a string and makes an array out of it. All right, that's what the split function does. All right. So, again, parsing is taking a big piece of data and breaking it down into its original, or breaking it down into meaningful pieces. The split helps us do that. So, we're going to split. We're going to do two splits. The first split that we're going to do is we're going to split that giant string using the colon. And we're going to create an array called A English. So I'm going to say A English equals split response, which is a variable that I put that data in, colon. So, what is that going to do? That's going to take this big string, response, and create an array so that A English 0 equals absolute value semicolon 0. A sub 1 equals addition 1. A sub 2 equals. So to use the terminology I used before, we broke that big string of data into the individual records. So each row, each element in the A English array represents one record. It represents every piece of data that we have about one word. All right? So we do that. So we've started our parsing of it. All right? Because we've taken that big string of data and broken it down. What are we going to do next? We are going to loop through this array. We're going to do this for as many elements as we have here. And each trip through the loop, we are going to create a new option in our dropdown. Okay? We're going to create a new option in our dropdown. So we start our index at 0. We go as long as the A English array is. And each trip through the loop, we are going to create a second array. Called A option that's going to take each row in turn. So A option is going to be different each time through the loop, and we're going to split it using the semicolon. So A option sub 0, the first trip through the loop, is going to be equal to absolute value. A option sub 1 is going to be equal to 0. So we have successfully parsed that. We now have the values that we need to create our option. We simply then need to create an option to insert into our dropdown that has a value of this guy, and who has a text of this guy. So we need to create an option in there. After we create the first option, we loop through and create an option for the second element in the A English array, then the third, then the fourth, then the fifth. And we do that until we've done every field in our data. So then we're done, and we've created our dropdown. So that's it in concept. Now let's see it in code. Wrote the split function wrong. You'll see what it should look like in a second. The split function actually should look like this. A English equals, I said split, HTTP response text, colon. It should be HTTP response text dot split, colon. And I really don't need this variable. I created that variable and I never use it. So you can ignore that. So this is the first split. So I've split that big string into its individual records. So now I have as many rows in A English as there are that got returned. I then loop through, and for each element in this array, I split the record. Remember, A English sub I contains each record that we're looking at in turn. The first time through, it will contain the zeroth one, the second time, one. And I split A option using the semicolon. So A option sub 0 is going to be the word. A option sub 1 is going to be the value. Now, this statement's a little tricky. In the past, when we have created HTML, we've used inner HTML. And we could do that here as well. All right? We could absolutely do that here and create a big giant string that contains all our option tags and then set the inner HTML. But there's actually a better way to do it. We can actually create those objects through our code and add them to the dropdown. So, DD is our dropdown. We've gotten a pointer to it. We haven't used getElementById. We use the name of the dropdown. And we refer to it this way. Remember, that's simply an alternative way to point to an element on our page. And remember I said that a dropdown is really just an array of options. The DOM for a dropdown is really just an array of options. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to add to my dropdown an options array element. So I'm adding to the options of the dropdown. At what position I'm doing it? Well, whatever the current length is. Now this is the tricky part, right? Because what did we set the length of it up here to? We set it to 0. So right now, DD options length, the first time through the loop, has a value of 0. All right? Because there's no options in there. So we're setting that array element to 0, to a new option that we're creating. So the first time through, we are creating a new option, and we're putting it in position 0 in the dropdown's option array. Now the second time we go through the loop, what will the value of DD options length be? It was 0 initially, so when we add this option, we add the option to the 0th position in the array. So now how many elements are in the array? How many?
0.
No, there was 0 to start with, that's what this does,
yeah.
And after the first time we've added one, all right, how many will there be?
This isn't a trick question. We had zero, and we added one. The fact that this seems to be a puzzling question indicates that we're not understanding something here. All right? So if we started with zero, if I have zero cookies on the table, and I add one cookie to the table, how many cookies do we have on the table? We have one. All right? Substitute options for cookies, and substitute drop-down for table, and it's the exact same question. We started out with zero cookies on the table, zero options in the drop-down. After the first iteration of the loop, we have added a cookie to the table, slash option to the drop-down. So now we have one option in the drop-down. So the second time we execute this loop, we're going to create a new option. And in what position are we adding it? Well, how many are in there now? There's one. So we're adding it in position one. Third time through the loop, how many are in there? There's two. We're adding our new option in position two. So after the third time through the loop, there are three elements. So each trip through the loop, we're adding a new option to the drop-down. So that increases the value of this. All right? That increases the value. So the next time through the loop, we're going to add the option one position further. So DD options has a value of zero initially. We go through our first loop. We parse the record to get the two fields. We create a new option using this as the text and this as the value. That's the syntax to create a new option object. And again, the first argument is the text, the second argument is the value. And we add that new option object to our dropdown. How do we add it? Well, we point to the array of options, and we put that new option in whatever the length currently is. So before we've added any, that length is zero. So the first one that we add goes in position zero, which is the top one on the list. All right? And then, after we've done it, then the length of the drop-down is no longer zero, it's one. So the second drop-down then comes in, or the second value set of values comes in, and we add it in position one, add it in position two, and so on. Each trip through the loop, we're adding it one step further with what indicates the new length. What could be useful in some cases is I actually put alerts in. You could put an alert to show DD options length, and you'd see how it goes from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. We could put an alert to show the value of A option 0 and A option 1 to see how we're looping through the result text. But the effect of all this is when we are done, we have a dropdown that contains a set of options, the text of which is the word, and the value of which is the index in the array. Now, I've been typing in A all the time, so our numbers start with 0. But if I were to type in S, for example, notice that we get those higher numbers, right? Because S is further along in the alphabet, so this isn't at the start of the array, this is somewhere in the middle of the array. So, if we were to do this within our AJAX, our dropdown contains for the text, scientific notation of that option, the value it contains, whatever that array element was. Unfortunately, if we do a view source, we don't get to see that. Because the view source shows us what was sent back originally when we first requested this page, not what we've manipulated AJAX-wise. Any questions about this? The thing to keep in mind is that each time through the loop, we are adding an option to that dropdown. How do we add it? Well, we split the record into its two fields. We do this to create an options object. All right, that's a DOM expression. It's nothing I made up. That's how you create a new option for a dropdown. And then we add it to the list of options that are contained in that dropdown. And the thing to keep in mind is that each trip through, since we've added a new option, each iteration through the loop, the value of DD options length goes up by one each time through. So each new option we're adding after the previous option. So if there's 10 options, we add in one in position 0, one in position 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Questions on this? We can revisit this more in detail next week if we need to, if you have questions with it. Because we're going to see this. This is actually, there's two things that change in the different versions of this. Remember, we have actually three versions of this application. One that does XML data, one that does JSON data, and this one which does delimited data. The thing that's different between these two, between the three versions, number one, the server-side code is different because we're pumping out the data in a different format. And this create DD, which parses the output of the server, is different. Now, to go full circle and to finish this up, we're going to do the very last step. And the very last step is really, really, really simple. Right? Because we have a button that says get translation. So I pick second degree and I click go and I get the translation into Spanish. All right? This is really straightforward. We have an on click get translation. Now that also is going to make an AJAX request. But it's going to make a different kind of AJAX request. It's not going to get a list of things. It's going to get one value. That is, it's going to get the Spanish translation for that. Now, I'm grabbing the value of the. This could be replaced by I document. This could be replaced by dot value. This is sort of an older way of doing it. But I grab the value of the selected index. If that value equals negative 1, then that represents select a valid word. Because if you remember our server-side code, if there are no valid words, it sends back a message that there are no valid words, and it supplies a value of negative 1. So if the value of the drop-down option is negative 1, that means they haven't selected a valid word. At any rate, so if they selected something as a value of negative 1, that represents it's not a valid word, so we display that message. We don't even have to ask the server for that, because we know negative 1 means it's invalid. However, if they have selected a valid word, we call dictionary2.php and give it an index of whatever the value of that dropdown was. We then say on ready state change, display translation, and let's see what Dictionary 2 does. Dictionary 2 is probably the simplest program you're going to see in this class. It simply takes that index and returns the element in the Spanish array that corresponds to that index. So if I've picked element 37 from the array, that corresponds to the English word 37, the value in the Spanish array of 37
is the corresponding translation. Remember that we have this array. Which I turned a parallel array because the values match up. So number 3 is addition in English. If I look at the Spanish translation, element 1, 2, 3 is a Spanish translation for addition. So that's all the server does. So if I pick Dictionary2.php ?index equals 2 simply returns a Spanish translation for it. This is simple data. This isn't even delimited data. It's simply one value. So there's no need to parse this, right? My response text is my answer. I don't need to break that answer down into its pieces so that I can create something with it. Whatever I get back from the server is my answer. So therefore, my HTML, when I've gotten an answer, I can simply take that answer, the response text, and pop it into the inner HTML of my results field, my results div. So I simply pop the answer right there. The second part of this stays the same for all of them because there's really no need to send the data back in any other format. All right? And that brings back an interesting consideration that we'll talk about more next time, is don't consider one of these options as being superior to the other option. They're tools. What I mean by that is delimited data, XML, and JSON. We'll see how they have their own distinct advantages and drawbacks. So it's not like one is a better version of the other. It just depends on the problem that you're trying to solve. You know? Screwdriver is a perfectly good tool, right? But not if you need to nail a nail into a board. You need a hammer for that. So you're not going to look at a situation where you need to nail something and say, well, a hammer is the best tool because I used it to do this. Well, yeah, it was the best tool in that situation. It's not universally the better tool. Same idea with delimited XML and JSON. For any given problem, one of them might be a better way of doing it than the other. But that's not a universal thing. That's for that specific problem. All right, we'll continue this. If some of these concepts are fuzzy, remember, we get to see the same code again next week, just with slightly different versions. So study it. If you have any questions, you can ask them now. We'll also go over this more next week. Are there any questions now? All right. We'll see you in lab.